The Gorecast is brought to you by American Horrors, the greatest uncut horror channel in the world. 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all horror. As well as the Station of Decapitation Without Your Head.
America's longest running horror channel, www.withoutyourhead.com.
The following program is rated TV-MAL. It contains strong language and is intended only for mature audiences. Viewer discretion advised.
Sorry, I named things badly there. Whoops. Sorry about that.
Hello.
No.
You. Hello. Welcome to the Gorecast, where things are a little bit smoky in here. We're trying something new. It's okay. We'll get the hang of it.
Well, we're doing dark fantasy tonight on the TV show and here, so I thought some smoke.
Plus we have...
Which I'm instantaneously regretting. It doesn't hang around like the old smoke, actually. It does here, but not back there. I don't know if it'll have to work. Maybe it's because of the fan. There was a fan on.
Maybe I got the wrong stuff.
HDMI.
That's okay.
Yeah, it'll be good.
That's good. We'll occasionally waft some smoke. Albeit from us, or from back there. One or the other.
See how it goes.
One either. I'm Johnny Dedly. This is The Giz. You're here on the Gorecast this Sunday. You're here on the Gorecast this Sunday where the theme all week ends on everything we've been on has been dark fantasy.
Yes.
Horror me knows dark fantasy. We're doing dark fantasy on the TV show.
Yes.
We're doing dark fantasy tonight.
Yes.
It's pretty much a whole weekend of dark fantasy. Partially spurned on from the release of a new movie, which made me go...
Yeah. It was like, Giz is up, can we do it? Can we get a little bit? Yes.
It works. It's so goddamn good, it's not even funny.
Well, it is kind of funny, but it's supposed to be kind of funny.
Yeah, it's intentionally funny the way the director's intended. Probably not God. Come to think of some of the things that happened in the movie.
Maybe not Christian God, but I'm sure there are gods that would appreciate it. Corn. K-H-O-R-N-E.
I think there's a W in there though. It's corn, I believe is how it's pronounced.
No. Corn.
Corn?
Skulls for corn.
Corn. Corn?
No.
I'm not going to stop saying corn, so you might as well move on.
Anyway.
Corn.
Oh dear. Yeah, so as you were saying, this week we're taking a look at basically that fine line between dark fantasy and horror. And in this case, most of the films that we're going to be viewing, that fine line takes place in the form of, well, quite frankly, one's imagination. Because at the end of the day, that is the beginning of all things, whether it's dark fantasy, whether it's horror, any kind of story itself. Now, when it comes to dark fantasy itself and the kind of that interesting little line, it's, well, when you say fantasy, people think elves and fairies and blah, 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 fantasy, or at least they did once upon a time. Now, of course, when you think fantasy, you're also thinking goblins, dragons, and... They brought a cave troll, or Doomsday, depending on what film you're watching, I suppose.
And boobs.
Yeah,
Game of Thrones.
That's different.
It's a different style of fantasy, but it's fantasy.
Yeah, I suppose. But you know what? You know, when it comes down to the swashbuckling fantasy, you always had a gratuitous nude shot anyway.
Just to back up what I'm saying here. Movie number one. Before we get into the movies. Just to back up what I'm going to say here.
It was actually automatically what popped into my head.
Movie number one, Gothic. Loads of boobs.
Yes.
Movie number two, The Unborn. What's her name from Banshee's Unbelievable Bum. The whole way through it. Any excuse this girl has to wear underwear and walk around, that's it. And I applaud you for it.
Yep. We were wondering why the poster was just her looking at the mirror. Well, after watching the film,
it turns out, upon closer investigation of the poster, the creepy little fucking child is looking back at her through the mirror.
Yeah.
I didn't even notice that until I was editing our poster. And I was like, oh, would you look at that?
Yeah.
Yeah, because my man...
Ah, yes.
Gene was just like... When you see, they cleverly put the logo down by her ass, so all of the important information that you need to know about the movies actually where most people, and I'd imagine women as well, because it's breathtaking. It's a great bum. Well done, you. That's it. And then Puppet Master, the Littlest Reich, was like a tit fest.
Yeah, but that's... Yeah. Yeah, that's so true.
Titties.
Carriage. Well, as I said...
Integral to dark fantasy, from what I understand.
I was going to say, well, if you take a look at a lot of fantasy art, particularly in the 70s, there was a lot of that anyway.
I'm just going to do a quick share here if you want to continue on with the
bash. Yeah. Now, getting away from the gratuitous nudity that so often appears in our horror films, thank the gods. at the core of the thing, the real definition between dark fantasy and horror probably comes down to just, I suppose, what side of the line you're looking at. I mean, you take any kind of fantastical creatures or you take any kind of fantastical story arc, supernatural entities, whatever, they are an element of dark fantasy in and of themselves. And all you do is you just dial that scare-o-meter up to 11 or 12, add in a fuck ton of gore and a story that, you know, hopefully will chill the bone, and all of a sudden that dark fantasy has become full-on horror, just with, you know, fantastical points of view. Now, as I said, the films that we're going to be reviewing tonight, two of them at least, the fantasy aspect is more akin to the fantasy of the mind insofar as characters' imaginations running wild and creating their own horrors, creating images, whether they be real or imagined. I suppose if they're real, then they're not really creating them. Ah, you know what I mean. And as a result... What?
No, I kind of flawed the logic.
Yeah, but creating these circumstances and these visions which become truly horrifying in and of themselves. And yes, okay, I admit, in one of the films it turns out that not everything is actually imaginary, but at the same time it is the mind that the audience is being given a view into that, you know, we're supposed to be playing around with. I mean, at the end of the day, if the audience thinks that a person's going crazy, then clearly everything that they see is supposed to be in the crazy person's imagination, so therefore it's the darkness of the mind. Similarly enough, the first film, everything about it is just imagination, and more accurately, the dark fantasies conjured by that by those imaginations running wild altogether. When it comes down to this core subject itself, if you actually look at most old school fantasy stories, they're actually pretty fucking dark in and of themselves.
Yeah.
Witches abducting children for eating. Well, first they're going to fatten them up and then they're going to eat them. Fairies or evil queens, depending on how you look at it, casting terrifying spells on toddlers and infants. Why? Just because their parents ran out of places at the dinner table. That's actually the thing behind Sleeping Beauty, by the way.
Yes, it is.
All of these things can be taken and have been embellished upon, and as a result, to be perfectly honest, a lot of the archetypical horror movie monsters that we look at today are merely modern representations of age-old dark fantasy creatures, given a different twist, given a bit of a modern upbringing, obviously, and just slapped around. Freddy Krueger is your typical nightmare. He is the nightmare. Whatever old-school entity you creep into the mind and distort dreams and potentially kill you in your garam sleep, that's him, you know. Other transitions are obviously a little bit more obvious, like gin. There's a good one. Great series of films. Well, first.
Fantastic drink as well.
That's a different... perhaps I should have said genie as opposed to gin.
That's tasty as well.
Okay, yes. But pure creature of fantasy that got turned into a decent enough horror movie character. The first one was better than any of the others, to be perfectly honest.
And the one Disney reference I'll ever make, probably in life, Robin Williams was a great genie, so.
Yes, he was, but of a completely different
nature. Yeah, he was more of a friendly genie.
Yeah, if anything...
Friendly, waka waka kind of genie.
Yeah, if anything, what's the name of the guy, the bad guy in that film?
I don't know. I'm not a Disney fan. I'm only remembering the genie because Disney came up in a conversation recently where people were trying to turn me on to Disney.
Gargoyles.
The TV show?
Yeah.
Is that Disney?
Yeah.
Oh, I watched Gargoyles. That was okay.
To be perfectly honest...
Okay, it turns out I'm not completely opposed to Disney.
To be perfectly honest, in the 90s there were a couple of decent Disney cartoons. Bonkers is one that I'd love to get my hands on just because it took the idea of similar to Who Framed Roger Rabbit. It's like a cartoon law authority. So you have a normal cop.
Cartoon law.
You have a normal cop working with a toon cop.
Right.
And they did like murder mysteries and stuff like that. It was decent enough. So yeah, some Disney stuff is quite good.
That sounds vaguely familiar.
Yeah, it's a pain in the arse to try and track down because I've tried. God knows I've tried.
Will we get rolling into the movies?
Yes, we probably should.
I'm going to rehydrate my fancy bottle.
The first film we're going to be taking a look at is the 1986 British horror movie Gothic, which, to boil it quite down, is basically a dramatisation of actual events which took place on the 15th of June, 1816.
It's the birth of a monster.
In Geneva, when Lord Byron, very famous and somewhat exiled poet...
Actually, quick check before we continue on. Is Byron in?
Oh.
Probably Boyz.
Because that'll be... Actually, we should probably do a quick hello to people while we're...
Yeah. Hello, Pam. She's upstairs, feeling sick. I hope you feel better. Hey, Darren McKenna. Hello. Katie McNeil. Guten Tag.
Hey, Katie.
And Martin Green.
Martin, how are you doing?
Fee Gates. It was all German, actually. Awesome. I was kind of apt with the last movie, so sorry. Odette.
What?
I think that's how you spell her name.
Hang on.
I don't know what he's on about.
Well, he's on about Nola, clearly, because, you know. Odette Yussman. No, sorry, dude. You got the name spelled. No, that's... Yeah, that's a no. It's completely different.
You fucked up.
For once, Martin, I'm sorry, but this time, yep.
I sound like a wrestling binge.
Oh, no, it's all right. He corrected himself later on. Odette, but it is Yutzman. Yussman.
You're a Yutzman.
Y-U-S-T-M-A-N. Anyway, that'll be the next film. Gothic, 1986 British horror movie, which basically dramatizes actual events, which took place in 15th or 16th June, 1816, where Lord Byron, famous poet...
It was a warm summer's night. And there was a lot of laudanum floating about.
Fucking hell, was there ever a lot of laudanum?
Fuck loads of laudanum.
They were drinking that shit like it was fucking tap water.
Chucking it down like they were disco biscuits and they were at an energizer.
Yeah, so Lord Byron once upon a time invites...
Casters of a core.
What?
Evidently the G is silent in our name.
Okay.
Hello, Hanley. How are you, sir?
Sure, how are you doing? But yeah, Byron invites Percy Bysshe Shelley and Mary Godwin... soon to be Mary Shelley, along with her stepsister, Claire Claremont, to his residence. He's kind of like a summer vacation home on a lake that I can't pronounce in Geneva.
Where shows it. I'll give it a go. I'm going to fail.
I'm on the wrong film.
Whoa. Well, that wouldn't help now. I like trying to do strange names.
Villa Diodati in Geneva. There we go. Yeah,
that's completely fucking pissed on my parade there.
Well, I thought the name of the lake was somewhere and it was a pain in the arse to... Anyway, also in attendance is John William Polidori, Dr. John William Polidori, there we go. The reason that all these people are rather infamous and the reason that this particular session is rather infamous is because...
Well, Byron's infamous for bumming boys and bumming girls and... taking drugs and drinking loads of shit and bumming more stuff and riding stuff.
All four of them were of the same mindset.
Yeah, but he's like...
Five.
...historically recognised for it.
They're all advocates of free love, as they call it.
Yes, but I am saying,
I know.
In the books of history,
yeah.
He did it to a level that people were like, I should probably note how much...
It's only because he didn't give a fuck and didn't hide it.
Debaucherizing he's doing up and down the place.
Hang on a minute, everyone's fucking doing it. It's just the case that he didn't fucking hide it.
Yeah.
Anyway, as I said, this night is important because it's credited as being the night that two very, very important stories were born. Frankenstein and, from John Polidori, The Vampire, which is credited as being the first modern day, I say modern, 1816 being, vampire story. Now, all of these take place...
Modern at the time, all the shit now.
Yeah, pretty much. Now, all of these take place because while drinking oodles of fucking laudanum...
Some people drinking more than others. I won't mention names of who.
Percy!
He will.
Oodles of the fucking shit.
Yeah, he stopped using it as a drop or two in the drink kind of thing and just started using it as the drink of excessive amounts. Although, as is stated later on in the movie, his only mistress is laudanum.
Yeah, in far smaller doses than fucking arriving at the Byron's gaff and he's got a... Actually, he's kind of...
Gives out the bottle. Lug, lug, lug. Gives out.
That's literally, hello, where's the drugs?
Are you laughing at the same thing that I'm laughing at?
The bar? Is Gorgon in?
No, but life and art and imitation and all the rest of it.
Oh, oh, outside of the Bum and Boys bit, there's...
yeah.
There's this trajectory of similarities.
Yeah. As I said, while they are...
You said it's too needlessly big words strung together.
Large words are never needless.
I can't think of a shorter way of describing it, so we move on.
While drinking, as we said, fuck tons of laudanum.
Shit tons of laudanum. Some are drinking respectably. Byron and Percy are hugging it in.
Percy
specifically. Percy.
Yeah, he is.
Lashing it back.
Byron presents them with the French novel Fantasmagoria. It's a... Fuck, where are you going? Yeah. Fantasmagoria, which is basically a French book of German horror stories, ghost stories. Now, they each take it in turns to read passages from this book, and that would inspire them to basically do a horror story competition. This competition would eventually lead to the creation of the Frankenstein story when Percy and Mary kind of worked them together. Percy Shelley himself did a fragment of a ghost story. Lord Byron did a fragment which had a character that Polidori would use for his famous short story, The Vampire, which, as I said, was written on that night. Yep. Now, these are all actual factual things. Although it can be debated that that the Frankenstein story was born specifically on that night, and it can be debated that some of the elements brought forth in this film, which would appear to inspire that story, were actually accurate. But as I said, this is a fucking dramatization anyway. Mm. So we're going to take the truth.
What a dramatization it is.
We're going to take the truth and we're going to spin it. And so as a result, you get this insane, trippy headfuck of a film whereby over the course of this night you get all the characters experiencing their own delusions and horrors, which then work into the theme of the night, works into what they were planning on doing, and are presented in such a way that there are times when the audience...
There is also a unified trip.
Yes, because of the... One of the things that they did was, because they're macabre motherfuckers, they decided to whip out a skull and do a seance.
While tripping balls on the laudanum.
Fuck yeah. Now during this, Claire Claremont has one of her infamous episodes, which is...
A monthly occurrence.
Yeah, and is basically...
Just to clarify, we are talking about the monthly occurrence that you're thinking, but she also backflips and starts foaming at the mouth.
Yeah, in Claire's case, it's signified by an epileptic fit.
Epilepsy.
So this kicks off after she has a rather vivid part in the seance, let's say, channeling demons and old ghosts and things like that. She drops down. And naturally enough, it's not long after this that the rest of the group begin to see strange apparitions and begin to devolve further and further into paranoia and almost mania, especially old Shiloh. Jesus H, tap dancing Christ.
Shiloh being Percy.
Fucking hellfire. That man is just in a bad, bad place. And perhaps I think the film lends insight into...
We'll do a blast for Percy.
Lends insight into his actual state of mind, considering that the notorious writer was known for being a manic depressive. Which, to be fair, probably inspired much of his greatest works anyway. So fuck it. These things oftentimes go hand in hand.
I totally get that.
Yeah.
To be honest.
There's...
You're getting too into it.
Yeah. Over the course of the film, one of the most interesting things...
Mr. Costable, hello, sir. Waves.
How are you doing? Hi. But over the course of this film, one of the most interesting things is the story within the story, which is, while the seance has been conducted, what dark and mysterious entity have these besotten... I was just about to say besotten idiots.
May I do it, Chris Jericho?
Stupid idiots!
Inebriated stupid idiots.
Anyway. Untrained seancing is a stupid manoeuvre in the first place. Hands down. Bomb, bomb.
That being said, an argument can be made that Byron and the others, being enough into their occult lore, kind of knew what they were doing-ish.
Bar the inundatedly large amounts of laudanum that they've all had, rendering them all arse to elbow.
Well, what kind of a Sabbath doesn't have inordinate amounts of narcotics used?
Anybody wondering what I mean by arse to elbow? Put your arse to your elbow and then tell me how coherent looking you look.
Try to walk.
There you go. I sell it $350 though.
Laudanum?
Hashtag new best friend.
Couldn't I get that since the turn of the 20th
century? I'd imagine
century.
He's just tantalizing her taste balls. Shake your fist harder, guys.
Can't use the right hand, fingers to the sword.
That sounds so bad.
And it's the middle finger as well, which is worse. Can't see this ring?
My flipping off finger?
Look. Can't take the, it's swollen on.
Oh, yeah. Have you tried spitting on it?
Dirty.
It had dawned on me as that.
It's alright. We're in the right film for that kind of thing, because if there's one thing Gothic fucking does, it's dirty. Like I said, because of the nature of the film, because of the nature of the characters, because of the nature of the fact that they're tripping balls and they all believe in free love,
this film
is inundated with sexual. What we can't say double entendre, because that implies that they're trying to do a double meaning. But they're
not.
Single.
We're
meaning.
Riding.
Yeah,
we're all banging.
Yeah,
I'm banging this one. No, sorry, you're banging that one. I'm getting face diddled by this one. I'm going to be feeling that one up though while you're doing that. And
meanwhile, Polidori's wondering who he can jump up on. And
no
he
one.
And he doesn't care who.
He's Mr. Fifth Wheel, kind of.
Well, no,
there's many holes.
He's mad after Byron.
That he is.
Many
holes.
But yeah, over the course of the film, the audience is led to believe certain things. And as a result, there is a certain sense of suspicion throughout the entire movie.
Make it like a ding-dong. Hello.
What?
Make.
Oh, yeah. But there's a certain suspicion throughout the entire movie that there is someone or something on the loose, and that at any moment,
this house.
Yep. And that at any moment we are going to all be witnessing nothing more than bloody dismemberment of various different people. And that's kind of the cool thing about this film. Firstly, you get a story that's presented in almost a classical sense, not just the setting, but the dialogue and the way that horror unfolds in it. You're not being blasted with anything straight into your face, apart from the obvious images.
Even the use of camera angles and stuff to tell the story by not telling the story.
Yeah.
It's very good at making you think one thing is going to happen. And then due to the complete trippiness of everything, sometimes they can just snap out of it and they're back to normal. Or sometimes the way the story is told, it's nearly like the storyteller's on drugs. As well, because there's this kind of ADD-ness to some of the way it jumps around, but in a very effective and disorientating way to help sell what they're selling in the first place.
Considering this film and any other recounting of this particular night are probably based on the diaries of Shelley and Polidori.
It's a lie!
That's pretty much it.
We all came to, and we had a lovely cup of tea in the morning.
Now, that being said...
What was that?
Oh, that was definitely Polidori.
Yeah,
because they all did have cups of tea.
It was like a combination of Page versus Irishman.
Hello, Polidori here. Actually, he was like that in the film.
He goes, Hello.
I'm just going to be here. But yeah, I mean, like, considering that this film and any other recounting of that night would be based on quite literally the diaries of madmen at the time, is it any wonder that we are presented with this proper full-on 60s LSD-inspired trippy shit? Now, it's not full-on out-of-your-gourd trippy, whereby, you know, the audience is left wondering what the fuck it's looking at. Instead, it is a gradual degeneration through the character's degeneration on their drug trips.
Yeah. And also due to the drug that they're on, the trippiness doesn't come in a, I'm tripping balls right now.
No,
and then fades off. It's a, I'm tripping balls right now. No, I'm okay. I'm tripping balls right now.
Unless Let's just
Percy.
Drink some more.
Unless you're, yeah, Percy was like, I'm freaking out, man.
Where's the bottle? Fucking hell,
stop
man.
Stop drinking that. I will not, woman.
It's my laudanum.
You want me to handle this demon and your possessed stepsister sober? Are you mental?
I have to say, Julian Sands did a fantastic
Julian
job.
Julian Sands did a great
fucking
job.
Awesome job.
I have to say, they actually all did an awesome job.
Yeah, they're brilliant. fucking Natasha
Gabriel
Richardson.
Byrne blew my mind balls clean
he
off.
He won, I think he got a Best Acting Award that year.
He probably should. It was fucking
for
fantastic.
Hang on a minute now.
Fantastic. If you're looking for a balls to the wall gore fest, this is not the movie for you. I feel you should, we should let people know.
Yeah, he did. He won Best Actor in 87 for his role as Lord Byron.
What? Like, Oscar?
International Fantasy Film Awards.
Even better.
Yeah.
Even better.
That's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was very good in it. Mm. The whole cast, start to finish, were great.
Like I said, one of the things that I really enjoy about this film is the fact that it is a classical.
It's a big fan of Crazy Bitch.
Yeah, but it, oh yeah. Claire.
Claire.
She's great fun.
She's fantastic.
But yeah, and it's
from like, the moment you see Claire, she's got a hairdo on her, and I'm not trying to paint people with a brush, but
it's 80s hair.
Well, let me think. Off the top of my head, there's her who has that haircut, and every character that Helena Bonham Carter has ever played in a movie.
She's never had 80s hair.
That's not... No, the frizzy crazy...
Out of 80s hair.
Who? Helena Bonham Carter?
No, Claire in the film.
It's not a carbon copy. She's got crazy bitch hair is what I'm trying to say. You defused my entire joke.
It's the eyes, dude.
It's the also
eyes,
the eyes.
The crazy.
Yeah. No, it's a comedy. No, first thing I saw was that is the hair of a crazy bitch. And then before the laudanum came out, she established she was a crazy bitch.
Yes, this is true. This is
so
very true. I liked her straight away.
Not trying to sound like a knob, painting people with a brush, but I painted her with the brush of crazy bitch due to her haircut and call it the dartboard. She's mad as a bag of spiders.
I found her kind of adorable.
I found her adorably attractive as well, but it doesn't take away from the fact that she's mad as a bag of spiders.
Oh, yeah.
I also found Marla Singer strangely attractive. She's also mad as a bag of spiders and got the crazy bitch hair.
Not the same crazy bitch hair. Different crazy bitch hair. Anyway, shall we summarize this one and go into a trailer?
Trailer and then we'll...
Yeah.
Final thoughts?
Yeah.
We have to come up with a different way of instead of final thoughts. I know final thoughts is a very good
summarize.
It's a bit too teachery, but final thoughts is a bit too Jerry
Springer. We are high quality edutainment, dude. Well, maybe we're not high quality, but you know.
Would you call it edutainment?
They're getting educated and we're entertaining.
I wouldn't call us educated. I wouldn't call them.
Did any
educated.
Of them know this before we told them? Therefore, they are being educated.
There's a very high possibility.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Harvey's watching. He's put me onto loads of movies. Anyway, regardless, we're
you
going to go.
Get my point.
You defused my Carter joke. I feel I'm old. Anyway, that dispute settled. On to the trailer.
From there, like Christopher Hagenstein, she had to experience it.
In mind to raise the dead.
Yes, the skull of the Black Monk. His appearance was said to herald disaster. Gaze into the eyes. Conjure up your deepest, darkest fear. Call that fear to form, to life.
Torture it has in store for us. Our creature. be there waiting in the shadows until it has seen us to our death.
In one night, two legends were born.
A Ken Russell film.
Yeah, close enough.
Well, it wasn't the Morgan Freeman dude at that stage.
It's not. I don't know. Anyway, as you can see, that was the trailer for Gothic, which is exactly what it says on the tin, because, let's face it, it's a film set in the era where Gothic horror was pretty much invented. And as a result, kind of shows us exactly what insanity went into creating characters that, to be perfectly honest, are going to be sticking around for hundreds of years from now, much less the fact that we're like a couple hundred years later.
I thought it was really good. Overall, it looked pretty cool. Everything played well, but I just felt there were some times where I get the haphazardiness of the edit, I suppose, but there was times where I just felt like, give me the payoff.
But that's...
Give me the fucking payoff. I know it's supposed to depict a trip, but like some of it was so well done that it was just like, give me the goddamn payoff.
I was going to say that's kind of part of the classical horror bit.
You mean a payoff?
Whereby it's all anticipation and suspense and fear through unknowing what's going to happen next.
Rocky Horror there for a second.
Okay.
Just the way you said anticipation. Sorry, Tim Curry-ish.
Was he transvestite? Was it?
Anticipation.
It was, so watch that actually.
It's a great movie. We only watched it a week or two ago. It was one of the group watches.
Nice. But, yeah, for anyone interested in taking a look at the insane mental processes, if one can call them that, but they were certainly mental processes, that went into the creation or the fermentation, one would say, of one of the most iconic horror characters of all time, go check out Gothic, because you can probably do worse than watching Gabriel Byrne as a mad bastard in the personification of Lord Byron, because he's fucking awesome.
It's how professional we've gotten. It's like one button, smoke. Other button, smoke goes away. One button, smoke. See? Smoke goes away. Then.
But didn't you just make it go away?
Smoke. Smoke goes away. I don't mind.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Sorry. The next film.
There you go. I'd like to call that fine quality edutainment, dear.
Edutainment.
They're learning how pure we can be.
Fair enough. Fair enough. I'm not even going to argue with it anymore. Mr. Sherlock.
Good day.
But next movie, which I hadn't seen.
Never
heard. I hadn't seen Gothic, actually, either. I hadn't seen I hadn't seen because it hadn't been in existence until we came across it, and then we got it and we watched it. Puppet Master was only out like a week and a half. Hadn't seen Unborn, somehow it slipped through my net.
Yeah, which is weird considering it's like
hadn't seen Gothic either, but due to the era, because it was
I have vague recollection.
It was 3 AD the year it came out.
I am not that old, you motherfucker. I was just about to say I had
3 AD after Dedly.
Ah.
86. Dedly came into existence 83.
That was 4 AG.
I didn't know you started your own taping time. Because we're currently in 34 AD. Well, 34.
I'm Rain Arts!
34 and 8 twelfths AD.
Don't care, time is relative.
I didn't know it was related to time.
We're all related to time. How else do you think it passes?
Edutainment. Nice.
Yep.
Edutainment.
Anyway,
2009, Unborn, which I hadn't seen, and fucking hell.
Yeah, written...
Very good.
Written and directed by David S. Goyer, isn't it?
Tis. He definitely directed it.
Yeah, written and directed by David S. Goyer. Executive producer with... Yeah, Eric Kripke is in there as executive producer, I think.
Kripke!
And
what's that from?
Supernatural?
Is it?
No. Well, Albuquerque is the...
It'd be odd for me to people know a Supernatural reference.
Yeah, no.
Outside of the strippers. Because it's...
Strippers. At last. Finally. Oh, man, that was brilliant. But, yeah, okay. The Unborn stars Odette Yotzman, who myself and you best know as Nola from Banshee.
Ass-kicking native Indian
tomahawk-loving fucking psycho. Nom, nom, nom.
Hmm.
Anyway, in this, she plays Casey, who is your average college student slash babysitter slash person about to go on the verge of insanity because as she's out for a run, she starts seeing weird dogs and a weird kid starts following her.
I have to say, for an opening scene for a movie, this set the tone so goddamn well.
Yeah.
And in a very good misleading way, because it's a trippy opening. She's out for a jog. She finds an unborn fetus in a jar. She sees
The glove.
She finds an evil devil child walker behind her that when she turns around, turns back, is turned into an evil dog with a mask on. Mad stuff. And then it goes back to her normal life. Everything's popped off. And she meets her friends. All that kind of thing. And they're going to make you forget. And then she's babysitting a little wanker. He's...
Matty. She walks in.
Atticus.
He's in... He's
always, he's in the middle. He's that creepy kid that's in loads of shit. Atticus.
Where are you?
It's Atticus. I can't remember his last name. It's definitely Atticus. I have an idea for a horror movie just while you look up the name. Atticus Schaefer, thank you, that's it. Based on Snow White, a beautiful schizophrenic girl who has 7 different personalities who captures young men and locks them up. I'm actually liking this. Who captures young men and locks them up and tortures them because she believes she can make them her prince and that will save her from her inner agony. Make it happen. I actually...
Come here. Come here.
I'm going to DM you afterwards. I have to ask you a question.
Fairly certain, you know.
I'll tell you what, I'd fucking make that. That's pretty cool. I got a kill room, actually, that I can use.
For filming. Not a real one.
Yeah. Anyway, film. Yeah, there we go. You can trim me.
Sunday. Good day to you, Byrne.
Hey, Byrne.
Head like a sieve. Forgot it was Sunday there for a while.
Nice.
Shound.
So anyway, Casey's babysitting and she hears Maddie talk. Actually, she has a fucked up dream or something.
She falls asleep on the couch. She has a fucked up dream. Then she wakes up and hears...
The voices.
Yeah.
She hears these voices.
Then she asks if Maddie is awake.
And he's shining a mirror.
Just waving a mirror in front of his newly born brother.
Keep looking into the mirror.
Sister.
Yeah. Keep looking into the mirror. And of course, when Casey goes up to kind of ask him what the hell he's doing, the kid turns around like a
perfectly
mad
natural thing, smashes her in the face
with the mirror.
ECW. ECW.
And then
ECW.
Says cryptically, Jambi wants to be born now.
I thought for a minute that he'd said Johnny D wants to be born now. And I was like, I'm already born. We've already established.
No, he did not. So yeah, Casey understands.
This movie happened 16 AD.
Oh, good grief.
That's wrong.
Probably. I'm not adding up your
26 AD. Sorry, I forgot a whole decade there in the middle.
Actually, I forget.
I went 83.
Dude, we've all forgotten a decade of our life along the way, okay?
Yeah, won't disagree with that. Moving on.
That house that I lived in down there,
it was a blurry time for everyone.
I forget, the threesome. Anyway,
you know the way that I boost the mic so that our audio is better?
Oh no.
Yeah, so like you whispering shit is like totally.
And now I know that. Anyway.
I thought you didn't know that.
No.
Okay.
No, I did not.
Saws.
Anyway, yes. Casey is understandably freaked out and leaves and starts...
Well, the parents come home and she explains, your little bastard child smashed me in the face with a mirror.
And she kind of...
I'm terribly sorry. I hope you're not offended. I'm not offended. I'm possibly concussed and hurt because he's got a right little... I won't look like he's got a right little right hand on
for a minor. Proper.
Oh, yeah. But my phone has no sound. No one else has mentioned that there's no sound.
Maybe turn up the volume.
So I assume...
Yeah.
I'm confused. Is there sound?
No one else seems to have complained.
No one else. Fuck, we'll keep waffling on. Otherwise we're just going to assume. We'll just subtitle the whole thing. It'll be fine.
Oh, God, no. I remember what happened the last time someone subtitled stuff.
No, that still happens.
Oh.
Anywho.
Casey starts talking to her friend Romy and starts getting a bit freaked out. Basically,
Romy, who's mad into dream,
dream
interpretation and all that moo-joo-joo-joo.
Yeah. Over the course of the film, Casey is repeatedly haunted both when she's awake and when she's asleep by visions of this ghostly apparition child who's coming after her, by basically visions of these weird-ass dogs, insects following her around, mad-ass stuff, to the point that she eventually ends up starting to look into her own mother's suicide and all the rest of it when it's, fuck. Romy spots there's something up with her eye. She goes to check out her eye.
Romy asks what's up with her eye because the girl has beautiful blue eyes and suddenly one of them's partially turning brown.
Now, after getting slapped in the face with a mirror, goes to a doctor, says...
Is it beautiful brown eyes and suddenly turning blue?
Goes to the doctor. Doctor says that she's starting to get heterochromia, which can sometimes happen if you get it low. Also, he asked her if she was a twin. This is intricate to the story. We're not going to tell you why. Over the course of the film, you learn various things about Casey's past, about her mother, about her grandmother, about a family lineage that actually is pretty cool because it turns out they had dealings with Dr. Mengele, that mad, evil bastard, which is kind of what propagated all of this in the first place because, well, before you know it, people are dead and old spirits known as Baduks? Badaks?
Baduk. No, begin with a D. Dabuk?
Dibok.
Dibok.
Dibuk. D-Y-B-B-U-K.
One of those five. No, one of those two. It definitely begins with a D.
It's a Dibok. Yeah. So, Casey ends up going up against a Dibok and trying to figure out how the fuck she can get rid of it. And we have Gary Oldman being an awesome rabbi.
Yeah, and Idris Elba being an awesome non-priest.
No, he's a priest.
No, he's not a priest.
He's a priest.
He's not a full-blown priest. She explained that she didn't need Catholic whatever, and he was like, number one, what I do isn't Catholic, it's...
No, he explained that his fields of study is not limited to Catholic.
Okay, whatever.
Because
he does wear priestly robes.
Yeah, because he's a priest.
Okay, Idris Elba. Awesome. Also, terrifying demon-possessed person.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This film is one of those cool ones whereby...
The jump scares are used in an effective and proper manner... Where there's the odd jump scare, and I mean maybe two that I'd legit call jump scares and one that I'd call on the fence. But they were used to prime you for much bigger, more drawn out scares that were to happen later on in the movie, opposed to what happens in a lot of movies, where they just slap 5,000 jump scares in there. And
plus, more importantly, this had a story. And a really good story, too, that had you going, oh, fuck.
Yeah, really good. Really good story.
When it starts getting into the back history of Casey's family, and in particular the stuff revolving around her grandmother, things like that.
Once the Nazis show up. We'll just call it like it is. Once the Nazis show up, things kick up a little notch, and we find out a whole lot of... Scheiße sprechen.
Yeah.
About the history of Casey.
Yeah.
Shit talk.
Yeah, I know, I got it. I remember my South Park. Sprechen Sie Deutsch combined with Essen und Scheiße has to be shit talk.
Okay.
Naturally. But, the Unborn is...
The way we learn. This is where, if we were in one of my chat rooms, I'd probably throw up a... The more you know, GIF.
And now you know, knowing is half the battle.
No, it's
G.I. Joe.
The more you know. It's like an NBC thing.
Ah, okay.
But there's this one where it's got an African-American dude, and he's in the GIF, he just kind of goes like this, and it goes, the more you know, kind of appears into the magical letters. That would have probably been what it threw in there.
Okay.
Got a little more into the GIF than I was expecting. Anyway, back on track.
Yeah, the Unborn is a cool and interesting look.
It was a very interesting premise to the whole thing. And actually a bit of a precursor to Don't Kill It, in a weird way. If you think about it, because the demon's jumping around people left, right and centre.
Hmm.
Not to the same ferocity and frequency as in
Don't Kill It.
Don't Kill It. But it's pretty much able to jump into whatever the fuck it wants, like.
Yeah.
Took over young Maddie there, like a...
You know, it's weird that you mention Don't Kill It, because David S. Goyer is writing the script for...
Don't Kill It too.
He-Man.
Oh, I didn't know you were going to go there. I do get the longer link, though, so that's good. We'll hit the trailer, and then we'll do our closing... or
closing comments?
Yes! Okay, cool. Closing comments, that's what it's going to be. It's the GCCC. Gorecast closing comments.
Okay, so it's like Gotham City what? GCPD.
I'm going to have a quick conversation with Giz about fiction and reality. And then
no,
we're going to
I don't
back
need
in.
That comment.
So, where are the kids? The baby was down when I got here and the four-year-old conked out as soon as I read to him.
Case?
Hang on.
Some people are doorways.
What are you doing, Maddie?
You have to go with him.
Ah! He wants to be born now.
Case, there's something wrong with your eye.
What are you talking about?
One iris is a different color than the other, which happens occasionally when you're dealing with twins.
I'm an only child.
Hey, you all right?
Am I a twin, Dad?
He died while the two of you were still in utero.
Your mother never told you, but I knew. By living, you denied it entry into our world.
To be haunted by someone who's never even born. What's happening to me is real.
Get out of here! Go!
It's not safe to be around me. How do I stop it?
And this is the video record of the attempted exorcism of Casey Belden.
You sure you want to go through this?
And we're back. God. That's the trailer for...
The Unborn.
The Unborn. I fucking really like this. Really like this.
It was... I like the...
The camera movement through all of this made everything seem so... Even with disjointed dream sequences. The dream sequences are very well shot as well, but... As in, you know, you get dream sequence and then it's real life, but there's this fluidity to everything. I never really felt like I was out of the... Once you start the movie,
yeah,
you're in the movie.
I was going to say the pacing of it, because there's always something happening. Yeah. You know, it's one thing to watch a film whereby you're...
Sure, it's on bunch.
You're in a position whereby you're looking at a character going, okay, so everyone thinks the character is going crazy and every now and then something happens and only the character sees blah, blah, blah. It's another thing when you're watching a film and stuff is constantly happening to the main character to the point that you're kind of like, okay, this is full on and intense, and if she has blown a gasket, then it's pretty fucking severe and she wouldn't be as rational as she is, and okay, let's see where this is going. And as a result, you do find yourself fairly hooked, and you are, it's the story. Once it starts unraveling, you're kind of like, yeah, this is actually, this is really interesting. I want to see where this is going. So yeah, overall, I think The Unborn, definitely a good glimpse into...
Yeah, and my lovely girlfriend let me know that she actually has it on DVD, which I found out after I bought the digital download. So you don't get special features with the digital download, so I might check out the DVD. Because, like, it's not gory, because I think it was PG-13 rated. I don't think it was over... I think it was actually PG-13, I remember reading. But, fuck, man, PG-13, the scares were good.
Yeah.
What bit of graphicness you got.
Even the backstory was ominous.
Yeah.
I mean...
Yeah. It was just so well-paced, so good, absolutely brilliant. Would totally, if you see it in a shop or a DVD store...
Yeah, definitely,
or,
okay.
I think I picked it up for like £6. No. Which is pittance, do you know what I mean? You drop that in a bus.
What buses are you in?
No, I mean like, you drop that on a bus. It's change, is what I'm trying to say.
You go rolling after and pick that up, Scrooge and dump that shit.
Bus money.
My bus money. Fall out of my pocket.
Yeah, but it was your bus. It was your money. Now it's the germ-ridden bus floor money. Anywho. Go out and get it. I know it's a slightly older one. I know they're all slightly older ones. Everything's good. Go get it. Invest a lot of money into movies this week. Actually.
Well, yeah.
So that's why I missed the screeners. Screeners are great. The last movie. This was worth the $14. And if you were in America, and I will try and find the image before we go, there is a limited theatrical release in certain states around. Go see it in the cinema, because I can only imagine what this is like on a big screen. It's going to be great. Which is the latest installment into the Puppet Master franchise.
Yes.
Since it got retaken over by Blue Moon and Fangoria, who are now making movies.
Yeah, and it's kind of a reboot, I think, to the franchise as well.
Yeah, there was. It's been a reboot since the last one. It was also Fangoria and Blue Moon Productions.
Okay.
If I have it right. I think it's Blue Moon, isn't it?
Full Moon.
Full Moon, sorry. Full Moon Productions. Blue Moon's different. No, it's also horror, but it's old school 80s howling and shit like that. This is the latest installment in the Puppet Master series. So it picks up with, what's his name again?
Edgar.
Yeah, I can't remember his last name. Edgar's, well actually no, it picks up with Udo.
Yeah, it starts off, to be honest, this film does a fantastic job, if you've never seen the Puppet Master movies before, of introducing
familiarising you in a very quick, and it gives you what you need to know.
Yeah, it starts off in 1989, which is when the original movie was made and set. Gives you a quick introduction to the main character when he was still knocking around and what kind of a person he was. And shows you exactly what...
Toulouse.
Toulon.
Toulon, sorry. Yeah,
Andre Toulon. And shows you exactly...
Toulouse in my head. There was a song called Toulouse. It's great.
But it also shows you exactly what methods Toulon uses when it comes to him being a despicable, deplorable, horrible, murdering bastard.
Say that again now.
Despicable, deplorable, horrible, murdering bastard.
It's the last bit. Where's the twang come from?
Yeah.
Okay.
But, the opening sequence just shows briefly Toulon doing what he does best, being a horrible git and then committing a murder, and then the law arriving on and a shootout in his house.
Yeah.
It also shows one of his puppets basically under his control being told to stay in the shadows, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And then we fast forward to modern day, where Edgar, who is recently divorced...
No, we're forgetting a very cool bar scene.
No, that's the start of it. It's how we're introduced to Toulon.
Yeah, but...
I was going to say, what's his name? I can never remember the actor's name.
Udur Kier?
Yeah. I was going to see him in it. He's in loads. He was the...
Yeah, he plays Toulon for the opening scene.
Yeah, I thought, sorry, I might have moved into another bit of the movie. This is a kind of a flashback.
Yes.
With more puppets, and I thought you were talking about the flashback, not the...
No.
Yeah.
But, yeah, after that takes place, we're brought to modern times where Edgar, recently divorced and moving back in with the parents.
Who has a loving mother, and he has what I'd imagine is a loving father, but he's a very stern ex-cop who is a little bit upset that he's presumably 40-year-old son.
It's not just that. He's looking at him kind of going, that one was a looker as well.
Yeah,
not going to find another one
like
that.
He's upset about his 40-year-old son being divorced and that he has a failed career of what I believe he referred to as drawing pretty pictures.
And working in a comic book shop. Somebody's out of touch with reality, and it ain't Edgar this time.
Yeah, he's never seen a Marvel movie. He doesn't understand that there's money in comics now.
Never been to a comic book convention either and doesn't understand, hey, guess what? Pretty girls now like cool shit too.
He obviously didn't. Yeah, and then he meets a 7.5.
Markowitz.
Edgar's, hashtag remember Markowitz.
Edgar's boss. Is he his boss? Does Markowitz own the shop or something?
There will be some minor spoilers in this. We're going to try and keep it spoiler free because it's super out new and you need to super watch it.
Edgar quickly meets Ashley, who lives across the street from his
Ashley
parents.
Quickly meets Edgar. Let's get a story straight now.
Yeah,
Edgar's pulling out of his drive and Ashley is...
He's like a dart.
It's why when the detective says something later on that I'm like... You clever motherfucker. Because wasn't that all within the conversation of the doll?
No.
Well, I like the way his brain was going. He might have been batting from left field, but the logic is not unfounded.
I liked her reaction to it.
Yes.
But actually, blah, blah, yes. blah, 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 blah. Right.
No, that was the reaction. Blah, 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 blah.
With him?
Yeah. Because he's like a three.
Do you ever, it's fucking...
He's played by, I can't remember the actor's
Thomas
name.
Thomas Lennon,
who's in Santa Clarita Diet. He's the principal.
I was going to say probably best known as being fucking Dangle from Reno 911. Jim Dangle.
Reno 911? Was that the guy on the bike? No, the motorbike renegade cop kind of guy.
In the bike, in the shorts.
Oh, Jesus Christ, really?
Yeah, that's him. I knew it as soon as I saw it, man.
That's old school.
Thank you very much. Remember getting baked on the Google watching that? It was great fun.
Reno 999.
911.
Whatever.
There was a movie with The Rock in it.
Reno 999?
Dwayne The Rock Johnson was in a movie, and it was brilliant because he... Yeah. He's in the film for like 5 minutes and it's hilarious. It's absolutely hilarious.
You're hilarious.
Yes, I am.
Moving swiftly along.
Yes.
Anyway, Ashley and him very quickly but inexplicably end up in a relationship.
Well, like you said, man, she's...
She hits on him in the car. They're having a chat in the park and then
that's
in the chat in the park they appear to be together.
Okay.
Fast forward on to the comic book shop where...
Markowitz and himself working.
He's discovered a doll. We won't tell you what he's discovered, but the doll, to anybody who is a fan of the Puppet Master franchise, will be oddly familiar. Also oddly familiar to Edgar, because these things are relatively well known to a certain degree within circles.
Yeah.
Especially nerd circles like he's in.
Yeah, he knows it's something, so he goes there to figure out what it is. And it turns out it's the 30th anniversary of the massacre that Toulon... perpetrated.
Yep.
And as a result...
In the Toulon Mansion, they're having a...
convention.
Sell your dolls convention.
Well, it's...
Sell your puppets convention.
Yeah, it's been kind of turned into like a museum, so to speak. And as a result, they're celebrating the 30th anniversary. They're getting a bunch of the puppets in. There's going to be an auction. Edgar's found this puppet, so he figures, you know what? Set it on. Why not?
Yep.
He's discussing it with Ashley.
I was going to say, they find out about this convention. Then Markowitz cock blocks and self-invites himself in a very entertaining manner. And not that I'm slagging, what was it? Grindcore metal?
Yeah.
The line about grindcore metal.
This is grindcore. You've heard about it. You've never heard it before.
You've heard about it all your life.
That is it.
Yeah.
I was just like, yep. Because I've always, not slagging grind metal, because all music's good music to me, to a certain degree, but I've always considered in the overall realm of subgenres of metal, I've always considered grindcore as like the jazz fusion of metal, because sometimes it does sound a little bit like all five members of the band are playing beating to their own tune. And occasionally that mishmash meets in the middle into some sort of coherency, and then they all kind of branch off again and go into their own thing.
Attempt at cacophony.
Grindcore.
Yeah.
For noise all your life.
Noise Marines would probably play a grindcore now that I think about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Totally. So we'll skip some of the funny exposition.
Yeah. To cut a long story short.
We're actually kind of running
over time.
Start rounding it off. What's the easiest way? Okay. Yeah, go on.
To cut a long story short, because basically this is a mass gathering of Toulon's greatest works, because they have 60 of these fracking things supposedly coming along for sale.
Killer puppets, by the way. Just anyone who hasn't seen 60 killer puppets. Nobody knows they're killer puppets. But 60 killer puppets are all shown up to this hotel to be sold for an exorbitant amount of money.
All funds going to the Policeman's Association of the local city, whatever. But, as you can imagine, with all these things in the same place, it turns into a clusterfuck pretty fucking fast.
Yeah.
What is at first thought of as a spate of thefts quickly...
Turns out that it's puppets getting up and relieving themselves of their owners and masters.
And then relieving their owners and masters of their lives.
We're going to kind of leave it there to a certain degree. We'll do more review from now.
Yeah.
That's the backstory. I will say, once the puppets start moving, storyline to a certain degree goes out the window, and it's all about killing. And I won't lie to you, they have you kind of so primed with the little bit of pre-story and the little bit of story that happens in the middle before the more killing happens, all flows together beautifully.
Yeah.
And I've seen some mad shit happen in cinema.
I know what you're thinking of. I know exactly what scene you're thinking
of. I have seen some mad shit happen in cinema. This is by no means the maddest, but just because of the comedic tone to a lot of the movie,
yeah,
I wasn't expecting it to go there, because it got dark quick.
Actually, because of the comedic tone of the film...
It's probably why it was so bloody effective, because I really was not...
As soon as I saw the setup...
Mm. The minute I saw it happen... I knew it was going to happen, but I was like, there's no way it's going to happen. But then it did happen.
Yeah.
And I was like,
huh.
Well, fuck me sideways.
Huh.
That was unexpected. Yeah. Not technically unexpected, because the minute I saw it, I was like, I know where this is going.
They couldn't. They wouldn't. Oh my good gods, they did.
Yeah, they went. They crossed the line.
Yeah.
There was a line in the fucking sand, and they crossed it.
They threw up all
over
it.
I didn't know I wanted that in my life. That was a definitive line in the sand where I've been like, I don't know, but I'd be okay with that. But no, now that I've seen it, I'm actually like, that was fucking amazing.
What's worse is there was something that I was expecting to happen, a certain coup de grace that didn't happen.
There's also,
I don't know if it's better or worse.
You also get introduced to, because you're not a big puppet master on the franchise.
Yeah.
You also get introduced to several different versions of Blade throughout the course of the movie, because there's different stages and different models of them. And loads of other guys that you probably haven't seen throughout the series, but you know the robot's been made. And if you know the storyline, you could understand how some of them turned out to be so crazy and sinister. But once the little bit of storyline stuff happens, it's basically just...
It's hilarity and violence.
Hopefully we don't get kicked off the air for saying this, but it is essentially, in a very funny manner, a bunch of Nazi puppets cleansing a hotel.
Yeah, because that's their motivation. Because
That's their motivation. Like, they're just anybody that the Nazis didn't like.
But it's that's actually pointed out at one point. It's like, you know what's happening is this, isn't it?
Yeah. It's because Edgar's a fucking legend, and it's because he's got comic book brain.
Yes.
And in this instance, as the cop said, because he tried to defute what he was saying, and he's like, well, you tell me what's going on. And he was like, huh. You know.
How are you figuring it all out?
This is on digital download for €14, if memory serves me correctly, at the moment. Well, 13 and a little bit. Can't remember what the direct, we'll call it 14. Totally worth it. I laughed my fucking ass. I was shocked. Soundtrack was great. Edgar and Ashley felt really natural together.
Yeah.
Like I bought them as a couple. It just felt really natural together. I feel he may have had some fumbles trying to get the bra off in previous instances because she had all these marks on her back. I don't know if that's very, very smart makeup and pre-storytelling or just... Either way, bras can be difficult for some people. Who knows?
That's why the gods invented knives.
Christ almighty. You're not wrong. You're not wrong, I suppose. Sorry, it's not just in a consensual...
Yeah.
...knifing.
You won't stab.
That's a lie in relation to this movie.
Yeah, it is.
Lots of stabbings.
Yeah. Lots of slit throats. Lots of innovative fucking violence, to be perfectly honest.
What else stood out in the movie? Markowitz is fucking brilliant. He's a lot of the comedy elements to this movie are actually Markowitz orientated.
Do you know what I thought was awesome? The scene with the whole tail dude in the lobby. You must be Markowitz. Why? Oh, do I look Jewish to you?
Don't ruin the joke. Don't ruin the joke. It's a great joke. It's phenomenally racist, but done in a very tastefully hilarious way.
It's not.
Well, yeah.
It was the perfect response, and it totally sold me on how he has been.
Oh, the response just blew him out of the water. Excuse me. I don't know why water is giving me hiccups.
Because it's that mixed in stuff.
It's Markowitz, it does, albeit coming from him or it coming at him, is the center of comedic entertainment in it. And I have to say, there's one character that I just fell in love with, Cuddly Bear.
Oh!
That man, he's a man that's got principles, but he's also a man who's got priorities. And I can fucking respect that. So, Huggy Bear.
Cuddly Bear.
Cuddly Bear, sorry. Huggy Bear is Starsky and Hutch.
Yeah.
Cuddly Bear. I get you. I feel that.
I can't.
I can't defeat the logic. He was totally fucking right.
Yeah.
We're hitting 10 past 12, so I'll tell you what, we hit the trailer.
Yeah.
And then we come back and we'll do our final thoughts on the movie, and then we have to talk about one or two things before we go. And then we go. Puppet Master.
Warning. This motion picture is one of the most violent films ever made. There are 21 scenes of puppet violence and sadistic cruelty graphically shown. The content and subject matter may be upsetting for those under 18, those with weak hearts, and those of delicate nature.
This cellar workshop is where André Toulon manufactured puppets. It is unclear how many of these puppets were made, though 60 or so of them are expected to be in Postville by tomorrow for the auction.
That's not mine. I don't really know how that got here.
Maybe it walked.
Hello.
Jesus.
Well, you definitely seem like a toy that a maniac would make.
What the...
Why would anybody create a Nazi puppet?
They're little, they're fast. Anne Frank was hiding in her attic. A puppet could find her.
Don't ask, don't ask.
Studio. What? Who's that? I should have put the trailer for this week's show on first. No, we'll talk about Fine.
Okay.
Just right off my shit. We'll talk about what's going on. So, as we were talking about earlier, myself and Giz are covering dark fantasy. More specifically, the fine line between dark fantasy and horror this week on American Horrors. 8:30 p.m. CST.
ish. Which is here. No, it's about 3:30 in the morning here.
What was 2:30?
6 hours. 2:30 in the morning. Yeah, 2:30 in the morning here, and whatever within the 6 hour time zones that are floating around in America. There you go. If you happen to have Roku, where American Horrors lives, you can put the channel onto your television set with channel code AMHOR and to add it to your Roku lineup. Or if you don't have Roku, you can also watch it because the lovely people at American Horrors stream the channel live and free on their website, www.americanhorrors.com. That's good. We'll hit the trailer, and then we have one more thing to talk about when we come back, and then we're ready.
We trailer or advert?
With it. Or trailer for our show, and then we have to talk about everything.
Okay.
Yes. You flipped me off there.
Sorry.
I don't know what the fuck we're talking about, man. Pan's Labyrinth is obviously... Pan's Labyrinth is obviously a horror movie. It's a magical world of monsters.
Yeah, monsters that are based in the fantasy world. They're all fairies and shit, man.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if they're fucking fairies, my friend. How about the entire war that's unfolding over Spain at the time? It's a butchering.
Yeah, proving my point. The entire war that this girl's imagination is trying to cover up. Hence it being a fantasy.
The gore, my friends.
Atmosphere.
Join myself and the Giz this Sunday on American Horrors, where we're going to try and... fucking define the line that goes between dark fantasy and horror. Bum!
Here we go, and we're back. Okay, so quick final thoughts on the movie.
It's just one of those films that you can turn on, sit back, and have a laugh watching some of the most hilarious violence you're going to find, and some really good one-liners, and...
Absolutely. I think I saw someone talking about one of the one-liners there. I think that Anne Frank line is one of my favourite lines in a movie ever. Yes.
When they're discussing why would you use puppets.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes. yeah, it's... What lack of storyline there is once all the killing... gets rolling, I feel, is just to get you primed and ready for the fact that, like, there's definitely going to be a sequel to this, and it really sets you up for the sequel.
Yeah.
And all of this is to kind of, I really think, put you in the zone of
insanity. What is going to be the next one?
Well, put you in the zone of what's going on in the guy's head that's going to lead you into movie two. And it's going to be very interesting. I have to go get this. Totally worth a watch. Get your mates over. Have a good time.
Yeah.
That's all I can say. And if you do get a chance to see this on the big screen in one of the places, I'll throw up... I found a poster with it, so I'll throw it in the comments feed after the show. Go check it out. And then mail us and let us know what it was like on the big screen, because I can imagine it to only be fucking amazing. Last but not least, our homeboys over at American Horrors have a film festival going on in October, as we know, numero dos, because last year was very successful, so they decided to opt on and go for numero two, and they're still looking for submissions, and the extension date, due to demand, has been extended to August 31st, so if you have a short film, feature film, anything like that, it's horror, it's creepy, fucked up music video, anything like that, send it in to filmfreeway.com/ the American Horrors Film Festival, or I'm sure if you type American Horrors Film Festival into the search bar in Film Freeway, you'll be able to get it going. And there's 50% student discount on all entry fees. Will I read the blurb out? I didn't realise there was a blurb at the bottom instead of me halfing through it. The second annual American Horrors Film Festival will be held at the historic Geneva Theatres, and then there's a link to the Geneva Theatres in downtown Lake Geneva, Friday, October 26th and Saturday, October 27th. And its participants, panelists, audience members, and everyone who walks the red carpet of death will be filmed for an American Horrors TV special.
Cool.
Which, if you happen to catch their first TV special that was on over the summer, was a fucking doozy. It was great. Absolutely good. So, as I said, short movie, crazy music video. If it's got horror and it's on celluloid, film, or digital, send it to filmfreeway.com and take a look at the American Horror Film Festival and get it hooked up. And don't forget to give us a shout out in your credits.
We're here because the Gorecast told us to come.
www.courtesyofgorecast.com. There isn't a Gorecast.com.
Yeah.
And then we'll take over the world. That sounds pretty rounded off.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Go get everything. Go get everything. I know that Gothic is on YouTube.
Yes.
Not in great quality and in 4x3. But
there's on
YouTube.
There's other
or free movie recommendation for them.
Yeah, there's other streaming video sites where there's better quality of it, I think.
I don't condone those. But it's on YouTube, so it's obviously legal.
I was going to say where, like, YouTube, it's certain content that gets put up.
Yeah, well, I'd imagine it's legal because it's
got
like 20 million views or something. Well, probably not. But it's got a fuck ton of views.
Yeah.
Really good movie. Go watch everything. Everything this week. This is another week of
awesome films.
Another week. And we had another really cool fantasy, except kids couldn't get around to seeing it. So we're going to do an old school Japanese.
Yeah, I didn't know the damn thing was 3 hours long.
Yeah, we were going to do Koidan as well. Kind of, in my opinion, the epitome of dark fantasy meets horror.
Okay.
I thought it's
Japanese-y goodness. Take your word for it. I just didn't realise it was 3 hours long.
Yeah.
Anyway, sat down at the wrong time to watch it.
Make sure to go over to American Horrors in about 2 hours. Join myself and the Giz where we finish rounding off and defining the overall topic of
dark fantasy versus horror.
Yeah, because this was more just really cool dark fantasy movies to give you a little smackling of flavour to lead you into the show. All movies we didn't talk about on the fucking show. Come to think about it, there's a lot of Del Toro in there.
With good reason.
Yeah, he's like the king of dark fantasy.
Yeah,
it's a horror. It's a fantasy. It's a horror.
It's Del Toro that explains everything.
You ruined it again, you cock blocking common fuck. Gorecast, goddamn. Mother. Effin' out!